lovely viewers, and welcome to another edition of our show, Captured by Women. My name is Priscilla, and in studio with me is Abena, Amma, and Susan. It promises to be another exciting edition as usual. So today we're looking at the highlights of what made news last week. First up, we'll be looking at the Bimbilla issues and the seemingly unseasoned wars of the Northern Chieftaincy and the disputes thereof. Then we'll be discussing the State of the Nation's address set to be delivered soon. We want to discuss the issues arising thereof. What are our expectations of the State of the Nation's address? Then we would also look at the free SHS. The NPP administration has announced that the free SHS is going to take off in September. We want to discuss if the strategies we have heard so far is what we were expecting. We're banked by Tinatet Herbal, producers of Tinatet Tomac, as well as Fenicure, and Leap tomato paste with no size. Your jollof would only have one witness.
Welcome back, lovely viewers. On The Spin, we're taking a spin on the Bimbilla chaos. But before we delve deep into that, let's take a short video.
And let's stop all this jovial way of addressing the issue where innocent people are dying. But the minister is here, Minister for Women. You are here. Take this issue up.
Tell them what.
Or in just 3 months, it will be something in the skies. We want peace and want you to work effectively. So hit to the issue. Get to the core point of it.
Tell them what.
Whatever reasons why they are not doing that, you make them understand that it is the law.
Very well. So we all watched that video, and indeed, it's worrying. And I think this was something that brought a security alert for which Bimbilla was locked down, under lockdown, and some hospitals shut down because they were being threatened or the security there was breached, and so they left. And if they are being asked to go back, of course, they have to be assured that security is on the high and they'll be safe, they'll be protected. But what worries me is that people should remember there are ways of solving issues rather than resorting to chaos or harming people, because the people they even harm, women and children, what really have they done? They're not even involved in whatever chieftaincy dispute you're going through. So as you're in a bid to get your people ensued or enskinned, you are harming lives, the very people you want to come and rule over. Now, I think it's high time we resorted to the laid down procedures for going through. So if you are aggrieved, go to court. Let the court settle it and agree with what the court thinks. I don't think we should all come to, you know, killing people and ransacking and spoiling state items, because it's costly, it's killing people, it's sad. Yeah,
it's sad. And I would want, you know, there are underlying issues to these violence that we see happening, and I would want the issues to be dealt with from that level, from the right from the roots. Because it would be an effort and futility if you dealt with, you know, and not deal with those. So I think it's important that we come together, or the stakeholders involved actually sit down and thrash things out the way they are supposed to deal with it, so that we don't have these issues recurring. Because like you said, you know, with the lockdown of the town, economic activity comes to a halt, you know, and you're talking about development issues here. Lives are lost. I mean, the last count, I believe, was 10 people lost, out of which 7 were women.
Yeah.
2
and men. 11 injured.
Exactly. That's totally not appropriate. We need to deal with the issues, but deal with the issues appropriately. Identify exactly what the underlying issues are and then deal with it.
Definitely. In support of what Abena has just said, getting to the cause, I mean, the very roots, we would entreat all our statesmen who come from Bimbilla, who knows the nitty-gritties of the issue, to have a stakeholder engagement or meeting. We want to hear them contribute their quota in this matter. They shouldn't just leave it to the Interior Minister, who might not know the nitty-gritties of it. He might know it, but it will help if we have persons coming from there, speaking to the people as one of their own, and, you know, entreating them to resolve matters with, you know, discuss instead of using weaponry and all of that. And it goes to state how much people value their lives. This says the level of civilization they are exposed to and what they live for. They don't care. You take arms, they take arms. You know, it should be looked at critically. In today's modern day civilization, we cannot have this kind of means of resolving issues. So please, all statesmen who come from Bimbilla, who come from the north, who understand the nitty-gritties of the issue, we entreat you to engage the relevant persons.
Oh, Susan.
Oh, well, I guess that this has been going on for a while. And it's important that the people realize that their development is based on peace and security in the area. And, you know, if they are to move forward, they need to resolve this issue. I think that as a people, we need to, you know, really catalog or have a family tree of inheritance and how things should move. It's not peculiar to Bimbilla. We're having similar issues here in the Gar State and who should be, you know, Gamancha, etc., etc. You know, I think that, you know, the different houses or the different traditions should find people and then catalog, you know, how the inheritance should go, a proper successive, tree, you know, who succeeds, who, which one is going next, who goes next, you know, and we've been relying on our oral history for too long. It's about time some of these things are properly catalogued, and maybe going forward we won't have too many of these chieftaincy disputes, because there are a lot of chieftaincy disputes in this country. It also goes to show that people have a lot of attachment to their chiefs and to their traditions than to the central government, especially those in the rural areas where central government is removed from them, and you know, and so, you know, the chief is the be it all, end it all, and they're willing to lay their lives down for it. Maybe, you know, we need to move away from that. I think Nkrumah tried it, you know, and over the years, I'm not sure how it has worked out, but the attachment is really still there. And, you know, but they have to realize that this is, you know, we're modern Ghana. Yes, it's good to have your, you know, the chiefs or the tribal headsmen or whatever, because it's who we are. But we should not allow it to you know, divide us and put people's lives at stake. So I guess that as a whole, you know, it affects the security of this country. The many chieftaincy disputes, Bimbilla, Gar, the Dagbon one, and there are many of them across the country. I think that it's about time that there is a minister for chieftaincy affairs. You know, they need to do a proper cataloging of the different houses and how succession should go.
Very well. But the way forward, like Abby said, it's again, it's not only in the north, it's everywhere. But I guess the northern areas tend to become very explosive, if I should say. It's not well contained, and so it becomes something where there even needs to be a lockdown. We've not really heard that when it comes to the Ashanti region and the other part. So I guess that's how come that. In what sense?
And that they, you know, they don't have too many of that because they have a king in which many of them hold, you know, give their allegiance to. In the different parts, the, you know, in the different parts of the country.
No, I'm talking about the wars that come out
of it. You, yeah, so the Ashanti region
is a dispute, it will not
where they don't
interact.
Have that many of those disputes, because if they went to the Ashanti Hene, he probably would settle it and that would move on. But the different parts of the country, there really are a lot of chieftaincy disputes.
Yeah, and I'm saying again, not as explosive as in the north, rightly, because like you said, in the Ashanti region is contained because we have the Ashanti Hene who they go to, who, I mean, has a good hierarchy of who should whatever go through. So I think, like we, I mean, the main focus turns out to be the north, because when it becomes, it puts the state and the nation of unrest, and everyone has to move up north, try to settle it, not to say, and then the worry then becomes, what then are the chiefs really doing, those who were there, or the kingmakers, as it were, because they usually have a committee or a board which makes kings, and if they make certain suggestions, because what I heard from this Northern State one is the Bimbilla issue is that one who's supposed to succeed as a grandson, grandchildren cannot succeed. Another person who is saying he's supposed to be is also was supposed to be a chief before you can do so. He was not a chief, you know. So there's some issues that are there. If they know these are the cases, then obviously they should know who qualifies, who doesn't exactly. And let's just move on rather than going back and forth with this and, like we said, arresting development and moving on with economic activities in those parts.
We just hope that we find a lasting solution to all these chieftaincy issues that lead to violence and all of that. I mean, we just hope we come to an end with this phase, you know, this chapter of our development and see better things ahead of us. We're watching Captured by Women, and on Big Bang One, we're looking at the State of the Nation address that is due to be delivered by the President sometime next week. And this obviously is pursuant to Article 67 of the 1992 Constitution. The President will be delivering his message to Parliament, the representative of the people, and we'll be looking at the state of the nation as it is when he took over. Indeed, we anticipate that the President will be touching on a number of issues, but perhaps more critically, he'll be looking at the area of education, where recently there's been an announcement. Actually, he did that announcement that SHS is going to be free and fair. The free and fair policy in terms of senior high school education would be taking off in September. So obviously, I'm sure that would be one of the areas that he would be highlighting on. And indeed, it's an area I would be looking out for, telling us more as to how that area perhaps is going to be funded or whatever. But also an area I would be expecting some attention would be the area of energy, because we all know how Dumso affected us the past couple of years. We'd want to see the plans towards, you know, solidifying or consolidating whatever gains indeed we have made in the past couple of years. And yeah, I'm sure other areas. So what would be your take, Priscilla?
Exactly.
State of the Nation, what are you looking out for?
Exactly. I mean, energy as well. I mean, for me, it presupposes that there'll be a lot of review of current contracts running, because in terms of capacity, the previous government has been able to, you know, accrue a lot of capacity which should serve the nation's demand. The issue then becomes the source of fuel and the funding thereof. And where there are deficits in our current budgets, we need to understand the reviews that they are going to make on the various contracts currently running and how they intend to source funds. Because mind you, there's going to be tax cuts here and there. They have promised a couple of allowances. So indeed, the budget is also going to be strained. So we want to hear the innovative sources of funding that this government intends to raise funds from to fund its policies.
Yeah, definitely. With my health bias, definitely I'm also looking at the reforms that are going to take place in the health sector, what the government plans to do for the health sector. Definitely, I know National Health Insurance Scheme will definitely be on top of it, because oftentimes, well, in the previous MPP administration, they introduced it and it worked well, and so definitely coming back, they expected to revamp it and make sure it works well. And I appreciate the value of the health insurance, because I know what it used to do and I know what it's doing now. Yeah. So I would want to see what innovative ideas they're going to come up with to revamp that part. Then again, the health sector in general, you know, recently the junior doctors in CAF are going on strike because they don't have oxygen and certain basic amenities. I'm looking at what this government is going to do differently to help make the health sector a better one for all of us.
I guess I am open, you know, I don't have really any expectations. I would hope that life will be better than what it was before, and that plans that are put there will be things that will make life better for Ghanaians. So I'm pretty open about it. Maybe, you know, I would want to see it in action. The MPP has been in government for only 1 month. It'll probably be a vision of what they want to do, you know, in the short term, coming out of their manifesto and the promises that they made. And so maybe given a year from now, then it will be easy to say, okay, you gave us this vision for your short term, for the year, you know, and this is what you've achieved. However, I know that the VRA and, you know, have been talking, Gridco have been talking that they're going to, they have some scheduled maintenance issues coming up, and that, you know, they should resort to Plan B to ensure that doomsaw doesn't happen. I would hope that that has been taken seriously. I think that it sort of passed my ears about a fuel shortage if we didn't take care, that ought to be taken care also of. And hopefully, you know, something in the nation's address will talk about that. But otherwise, let's see if there are any surprises coming up.
I mean, also looking at the area of legislation, you know, one main bill before Parliament, which, I mean, I don't know why it's taking forever for them to pass the right to information bill. We would, I would want to see, you know, some traction in that, in that area to see, you know, whatever plans
Is it going to be a doomsday state of the nation? I'm saying this because obviously we also need to be informed
of what
as to what
exactly
the true state of the nation is in terms of the public purse. I think often the now vice president used to tout the president for giving artificial figures and all of that. So I think we'll be in a balance as to what they are going to say is the true state of the nation's you know, true state of the nation. And they also have to be cognizant of the fact that the international community who wants to come in to invest wants to know the true picture and the standing of the economy.
That's what I was going to go into, because finance would definitely be something everyone is listening out for, because we've heard certain claims, we've heard certain things being thrown about. We want to know which is true and which is not. And in that light, then what we have, what are we going to be able to do with what we have? And moving forward, how is this government? Because my main issue is what the current government has often promised in their manifesto to do when it comes to funding, that they're going to find innovative ways of raising money, not looking only at the purse, what we have now, the kit, the national kit.
Taxation.
But exactly, looking at taxation, reducing all that. So I know people...
Well, innovative ways, have we not heard that Ghana CC will be funded by the private sector?
Yeah, well, but is that going to be
time,
a real... Is that going
the
to be
first
true?
Time we're hearing, you know, this kind of...
But again, when it comes to free SHS, let's not even move it, because we'll delve into that later.
Yeah,
but going to the heritage fund, going to the
Twitch. Yes, it's true, yes, private sector could come in there. But looking at the timing, see, 6th March is just barely like 2 or 3 weeks away. And you know, it's not easy for private sector to source or mobilize funds.
But Unibank has donated some amount.
My worry with that is why they costed it. If it's going to be a voluntary thing, why do you cost it?
Exactly.
You don't know how much anybody's going to put in there. But I think the private sector injecting will have incentives.
Ultimately, that would be a good thing.
But Prissy, to say that you are in the finance, I mean, could they have gone on with this committee planning if they don't have a budget? Even though it's coming without...
They can have a budget, but to say that we're going to fund it with $20 million. I mean, Ghana City, where is not going to be, we're going to pick 20 million Ghana City. It's going to be a plus or minus. We are now sourcing for the fund, so we don't know who might put in and who might not put in.
But
so
what I was thinking was, then if they come up with this 20 million and their figures fit into it, then they'll wait for the donations as it were. If it falls short, then they'll supplement with our national kitty.
Back to
which, so we want to know in the state of nation address if that's what's going to happen.
Well, we'll look at that. But another thing, let's not forget, you know, the NPP came in on the wind of change, talking about doing things differently. So clearly I would want to see some you know, language that suggests that yes, we are looking at public sector reforms, you know, because clearly where there's public sector reforms, you know that the delivery of public services would be enhanced. So talking about health, talking about education, talking about sanitation issues and everything, I mean, you have a sense of some comfort in there. So perhaps I'm looking at, you know, something like that, hearing that kind of language about change and reforms in the public sector. I would be looking out keenly for such
and that's definitely the one something everyone is
do we have record of how every president's first state of the nation's address has been, because they want to see whether it's more economic or more on social interventions or more on
policies, legislature, everything.
Okay. That'll be a tough one, though, but at least they usually focus on certain areas that are of prime importance and then just muddy the waters with the rest. But yeah, we're listening out intently for that. Yeah. We'll take some short views from experts and then we'll wrap up on this.
What may likely happen is that they may say, oh, we are able to, given the current state of the economy, we are able to reduce A, B, C, D, and we are not able to do this. Or we can do this within this time frame, and then maybe moving forward, once we're able to get things stabilized, we'll be able to do A, B, C. So I think most of them may be deferred for, say, the first year or the second year of governance.
I want to believe that given the goodwill and the resounding mandate that was given to this particular administration, they will be up and doing, and it wouldn't be business as usual. So I'm looking forward to they fulfilling the promises. Let's have a very decorous house that would well receive whatever he says. Where they want to show disapproval, they can do it, but let them not do it in a manner that would create a kind of disorder, you know, in the chamber.
After the speech, the majority is going to say whatever the president says is progressive, is developmental, and the minority will always find reasons to. Maybe they may applaud some of the promises, but most of the things they're going to find an alternative way of speaking to it.
The president to come and tell us that I have identified X and Y problem, and this is how I intend to fix it. And those are the things that we will now hold him account on going forward. If you find out that the other ministries under his presidency, like the Ministry of Trade, trade really will not take off if the power sector doesn't take off. Power sector really, you industry, about a year ago when industry were asked, what were the two main issues that they faced? One of the issues that they mentioned was high interest rates and high cost of electricity. So if you look at high cost of electricity, if that aspect is not fixed, then all the industrialization which the president promised and he wants to do might not come into realization, because without cheaper and abundant electricity, you realize that they might not be able to resolve the problem that exists. So we all expect the president to come out, tell us what he has found and how he intends to fix those problems.
What I expect this current administration to do is to look into the interstate secession bill. I want them to look at that. It's been hanging in parliament for quite some time now. I remember that last year, they celebrated an interstate secession something in this country. We talked about it. What is parliament trying to do? Because they need to change some of the percentages as to distribution. We are also looking at the improved access for justice. That is, we've already said it, for women and children. A lot of people think that we are looking at women and children. But when we're talking about children, we are looking at both sexes. We are looking at both sexes. And then we are also looking at the property rights of spouses bill. It's been hanging in parliament for a long time, and that we believe strongly that something has to be done about. I just don't understand why these bills are hanging in parliament and it's not being passed. I don't know what is happening. Every time you hear that there's arguments here and there, but nothing is being done. And we are actually employing this government to do something about it for us.
In Big Bang 2, we're talking about the free SHS. I think that in 2012, the MPP made it one of their issues of free SHS. It was also an issue in the 2016 elections. During the week, we heard President Akufo-Addo talk about the free SHS and what will constitute free. Yes, already tuition from the free was free, but he added several things, PTA fees, ICT fees, etc. So I guess that they have made their calculations, and it's supposed to commence in September of 2017, the beginning of that academic year. Well, I guess it's a promise to the people of Ghana, and they are bent on implementing it. What do you think?
Well, it's a good policy, definitely. Some experts have said that the reason why Ghana may be in the state it is because education tends to be on the low. Maybe if we were all educated or we all had some fair balance, then development will be on the higher side. So yes, I'm happy if everybody can be allowed to go through a free SHS, get some education, they can move on. But before we move in, I think there's a video of okay. President making that speech, okay. which we'll take a listen to.
Free SHS will mean that in addition to tuition, which is already free, there will be no admission fees, no library fees, no science center fees, no computer lab fees, no examination fees, no utility fees. There will be free textbooks, free boarding, and free meals.
Free everything. Interestingly, we have some notes from GES, which has the approved fees of the 2016-2017 mm-hmm. fees. And looking at it, it's interesting because if virtually everything becomes free, then it means, well, what I understand for what we have mm-hmm. is that these progressively free absorbed fees, when examination fees cost about 10 CDs, library fees is about 3 CDs, ICT 3 CDs, utilities 6 to 10 CDs. Well, the terms we have, the first year, we have first year, first term, which for examination fees is 10 CDs first if you are day, mm-hmm. and if you are boarding is also 10. Then in the first year, for the second and third terms, it's still 10. Okay, so mm-hmm. 10 CDs runs across. So it means all that is going to go away. Is that how I understand it? Yeah, and then, yeah. Library fees across board mm-hmm. is 3 CDs. ICT across board, 3 CDs. Utilities for the first term in your first year, if you're day, it's 6. I guess because they don't use much. Then when you're boarding, it's 10. Mm. Then if you're in the second and third terms, you pay 6 for the day, 10 for boarding, and then continue. I mean, it's interesting because people may have thought these were huge costs. Overall, it will be
overall, definitely. Yes,
definitely. Even calculating the basic ones we've touched on, that's about 20 CDs per head. And that's going off from our national kitty, which we seemingly don't have much. But if the Ekufo-Addo government has always said they will plug the loopholes, I believe that if they are able to do this, then we can pick up those monies that have gone into the wrong places and put into this. So it shouldn't be so strange. I don't think it's not.
Plugging the loopholes and the kitty to cater to this, I think we've heard in the air that it's going to be coming from, the funding is going to be coming from the heritage funds.
But that is what
Osafo-Mahu is saying. We're not sure whether it is the government's position.
Yes. So it's still, like you said, in the air. It's still hanging around in the air until it's confirmed. Maybe we'll hear that in the State of the Nation.
That is worth discussing.
But if it is, then Abby, I won't be amused. I mean, all of us knew, because then NDC could have done that easily as well.
But they didn't.
Because we had planned not to touch the heritage fund.
So it's why did we plan not to touch the heritage
fund? To the best
fund?
Of my knowledge,
the generation starts right.
Yeah, so Prissy, I mean, basically how I understand the heritage fund is to serve future generations so that the proceeds we get now that the oil is working for us, when maybe it will run out. So that's when that heritage fund is to kick in. But if we're going to use it now for free SHS, then that wouldn't be fair to the previous government because they could have done same.
But they didn't propose that.
But no, they probably said it, but they knew it was a no-go zone.
But anyway, so like, no-go zone?
Anyway, let's not go to heritage fund.
I think we need to go through the
heritage fund, but bringing you back to the itemized bill, I think there's a disconnect somewhere because this is the 2016-2017 academic year.
Yeah.
So the things that the president mentioned were already free.
Great. So let's take a second take of that video, so we go through again.
Yeah, because he mentioned those things, library fees, ICT, utilities.
Already here.
The government was subsidizing with 58 CDs. Mm-hmm. So those were things that already were being paid for. Mm. Maybe the MPP needs to really come out properly so that people don't expect certain things and then get disappointed. Because, you know, apart from admission fee and feeding fee, I mean, there are things that people will pay for. But the rhetoric
makes it sound like people are not going to pay for anything. But this academic year, people are paying for things, or things have been subsidized. It's
right. So for purposes of a clarity of, you know, understanding on this particular issue as to what exactly the government is going to absorb, let's just take a listen again at what President Okufo-Addo said at the, is it, the school? Yes, Ikepeman Secondary School. Let's take a listen again.
By free SHS, we mean that in addition to tuition, which is already free, there will be no admission fees, no library fees, no science center fees, no computer lab fees, no examination fees, no utility fees. There will be free textbooks, free boarding, and free meals.
Well, yes, that was the second take at what the president said. So let's see, he's saying tuition out, admission fee out, library fees, science center fees out, computer lab fees out, examination fees out, utility fees out. But clearly from the record that we have here, which is the 2016-2017, which Suzanne referred to, we already have library fees in there absorbed. We have examination fees that are already absorbed. Utilities already in there. There's ICT. No science center fees, is
but
there?
But there's ICT.
But there's ICT, control. And there's no computer lab.
But there's science development. I don't know if that caters for science center. But
so it means he's mentioning things that are already, yes, that's, yes, already free. So we need to know exactly what is new.
Maybe that is coming. Fee.
But the admission fee is already.
No, no, admission
fee. That captures, is under general fees. So they actually pay for that now. Which is 25 CD in the first term or first year for a day student, but 487.2 CD for a boarding student in the first year, first term. Then in the first year, second term, second and third terms for a day student is free, as of now. And then for continuing students too, it's free. So I think the only substantive one would have been the boarding.
First year admission fee for boarding.
Yes. For boarding, and yeah, that's the only substantive one.
So the thing is that parents are still going to pay some monies. You know, it's not going to be a totally free thing. I mean, we have uniforms, you know, house dress, PE kits, school cloth, etc., etc., etc. I think that ought to be made clear, otherwise people will be in for a big disappointment and the backlash will go to the government.
I think it would be nice to have like a table showing this as it is, as against what they are proposing now, and then we'll be, you know, a better place to do exactly. But currently, even listening to him now, we do appreciate that there are certain, if you like, repetitions. They're already free. Exactly.
But I think substantive is the free textbooks, because they already pay 45 for literature books, 14 for exercise books, 36 for notebooks, which I think is quite huge.
Let's categorize them. 14 CDs for 9 exercise books. 45 CD for 1 supplementary reader / 3 core literature books. So that may not capture all the
free.
That's what I'm saying.
Free textbooks. So everything
is scrapped. Then
it's going to be scrapped on the book side.
Yeah.
But you see, I mean, this comes to, you know, implementation of the policy. But I would want to, for us to go back to the issue about the Heritage Fund. I mean, we don't know exactly if that's government's policy, but it's worth discussing.
Sure.
Because the issue about the SHS remains an issue. Because of funding issues, and so if one person or the senior minister is coming out with this, you know, thinking, then perhaps it's important that so you were talking about the fact that you think the Heritage Fund
should not be touched
for generations. Wait for whenever 2000 and something, and then you
maybe
touch it.
Maybe it's not that it shouldn't be touched. But if we had a purpose for setting it up, I feel then that purpose should be realized. Otherwise, it would be unfair to the previous government who could have used
it. They didn't bring it up. But see, another
thing. Maybe they didn't because they knew it was a no go zone.
Why is it a no go zone?
It's daring.
Thinking outside the box. Daring. Let me tell you something. How much do we earn on that Heritage Fund?
No.
2.2
Maybe let me be clear why I wouldn't want MPP in particular to touch it. It's because they have promised that they will come out with innovative ideas to try and reduce touching certain funds we have already raised. That is my problem. If any other government came on with whatever policy, then I wouldn't mind.
Fantastic.
But because MPP plans MPP, to come out.
Why? I'm a C. For me, it's innovative. Mm. Why? Because when I borrow a dollar today as a sovereign, I pay 8.5.
Right.
How much am I earning on the Heritage Fund? 2 Baby. Or less than 2. Mm. Very negligible.
Mm.
So instead of going to borrow funds to fund SHS, I would use the Heritage Fund where I earn so little on to fund this. And talk about future generations. What is a generation when their heirs are uneducated?
Mm.
So
you know, there's a saying, the best legacy you can leave your children is education. So
you people are making it seem like
I don't agree with the education bit.
That would be unfair. Because I said in the first place that I agree with this free SHS policy. Now we're coming to funding. Where this money will come from?
You're looking at creativity.
Yes.
You think this is creative?
They could be more creative because the Heritage Fund will run out. It's not a never, I mean, it's not like it's just sitting there. It will, there's money that will go into use. It will run down. So after that, how sustainable will this be?
First of all, we have a lot of funds coming from this, petroleum, oil discovery and all of that. There are a lot of management accounts and management funds that exist as it stands now. The point is, I need the NPP to, first of all, cost the SHS,
the free
SHS, how much is it going to cost?
Mm-hmm.
And then they should tell us the avenues from which they are going to fund it. Mm. And if one of those avenues
is
the Heritage Fund, I am not averse to it. I mean, they could also review the whole Heritage Fund, the 9% that is appropriated to it, and say, look, let's do 15%. We keep 6 and we use 9 to fund education. And mind you, petroleum revenues are going up, and there are more discoveries.
Mm.
Hess will come on board, TEN will come on board, E&I will come on board, so we will have more monies going in there. So percentages or portions of that will be appropriated to our education. We can't keep any money per se sitting down when we go borrowing
at
outrageous rates.
But even more importantly, sorry to cut you, yes, we've identified the Heritage Funds as the source.
Our
concern as citizens, mind you, not spectators,
right,
is that how well or how prudent is this government going to manage that fund?
Exactly.
So that we don't see it becoming a SADA or a JIDA, you know, that's what we don't want to see, for me. Because if we're going to put it to good use, then yes, let's utilize it.
Thank you.
But make sure that it doesn't run. I mean, we don't come say, yes, the next thing is the money has run into some other neighboring country or something like that. No, we don't want that to happen again.
I think that the Heritage Fund was put there for a particular purpose. You know, the petroleum industry is an extractive industry. At a certain point in time, it will end. It's not education of our people is not a one-time event. It's an ongoing process. So there ought to be long-term strategies on how to fund it and where we want to go. Free education is not new to Ghana. Neither even if the free SHS is not a new thing. I mean, is something that we've been thinking about for many years now. That's why tuition was free. The thing is to get to the point where, you know, maybe parents also take a certain responsibility so that, you know, it's not as if parents will shirk their responsibility and leave all to government, so that the quality of the education doesn't come amiss. We've seen the problem with our primary education, especially the public one, in a point in time where our parents could go to the public primary schools and attain the highest. You know, these days, a child from the public school, you know, it's hard pressed to find that child attaining their highest potential.
I want to interject, so, sorry, but I want to add to what you said. She said something about responsibility. You know, I think I will slam this government for not appropriating anything to the free. So let's say if you perform well or you get above a certain grade, exams fee will be free for you. If you don't, you'll pay.
So that,
you know, it keeps parents to keep their kids, you know, keep them in line, whip them, serve as something that motivates them. But when you say anything free is assumed to have less quality, so really I think instead of throwing things there, they should consider ways of also hyping the standard where expectations are. If you do this, then so and so will be free. So they should consider that as well.
Very well, Susan, wrap up, and then I wrap up on the whole show. I think
I guess that's where I'm coming to, where it needs to be structured where those who can afford, you know, to pay for something, be allowed to pay. If you look at it right now, a lot of the children that are even going into our secondary schools are those coming from the private schools where they already paid fees. We ought to make a situation where Peter robs Paul, and Paul will all forever be grateful to the government, and ensure that, you know, the those who are down there should make it the free, and then those who can afford pay for it now, and then think things through about how progressively we will make it free for everybody, even those who can pay for it. But I think that it ought to go into certain stages where those who can afford it now pay for those who can't, so that we can keep certain standards and certain qualities, but everybody benefits from it.
Great. Clearly, there are more questions than answers here, and more proposals to making this policy work better, if indeed, or when indeed it begins to be implemented, or we begin to implement it. Well, that brings us to the end of our show today. We've looked at, of course, the SHS and the fact that government intends to start with the policy or implementing the policy this September. We also looked at the Bimbilla chieftaincy issues, and we also touched on the State of the Nation's address that the President is yet to give sometime next week to Parliament. Indeed, it's been an interesting show, as usual. We've done this with the kind support of our sponsors, Leap Tomato Paste and Tinatet Tomac Mixture and Tinatet Venicare. And we will be back here, same time, same place, next week. Until then, do have yourselves a very good weekend. My name is Abnatebi, and I've done this with Priscilla, Suzanne, and Nanama. We'll see you next week. Bye-bye.